to God.
Amen.
He is alive. In him we live, move, and have our very being. Amen. If you don't know that, you need to come to know that today, because God is alive. Some declared God to be dead a while back. But God fooled us and showed them day by day that God is alive.
Amen.
We want to welcome those who are visiting with us and say you are indeed our honored guest. We don't take your visit lightly. We never do.
Amen.
We always take the idea that God sent you by here to be a blessing to us as we endeavor to be a blessing unto you.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
I want you to be finding your way to Psalms, the 103rd Psalm. Amen.
Amen.
The fifth division of the Psalms is the 103rd Psalm. If you have it, say amen.
Amen.
I read to you verses 1 through 5. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all of his benefits, who forgiveth all of thy iniquities, who healeth all of thy diseases, who redeemed thy life from destruction, who crowned thee with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagles. Some of you might remember a while back that there was a artist named Denise Williams, or better known as Nisi. She had a song that she sung was called Sending Me Forget-Me-Nots. Y'all remember that? Some of y'all don't know. It's okay this time. So I thought I might talk to you this morning about forget-me-not. As people saved by grace, we have a problem that affects every single one of us this morning. Our problem is that we are forgetful. Oh, we can remember all kinds of things, especially what others have done to us or have said about us. Are y'all still out there? But we tend to forget that which the Lord has done in our lives. We have a long memory when it comes to our hurts, our sorrows, and our burdens. But a very, 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 very short memory when it comes to recalling just how good the Lord has been to us and for us. David also had that problem. And in these first two verses, David calls upon his soul. Are y'all still there? To remember what the Lord had done. He wants to stir up the inner man. Wants the inner man to get excited about what God has done. What the Lord has promised to do. For him and in him. Are y'all still there?
Yes.
David calls upon his soul to do two things. First, he calls upon his soul to praise the Lord.
Are y'all still out there?
Somebody say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
The word blessed means to kneel with the idea of adoration and praise. David knows that God is worthy of all the praise we can render to God. And David wants his soul to be involved in praising the Lord. There's nothing wrong with praising God.
Amen.
Folks, I might add that it's not just about going around saying it. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. And the second thing that David wants is not only does he want his soul to praise the Lord, but he also wants his soul to ponder the Lord. Are y'all still there? He challenges his soul not to forget what the Lord has done for it. Note, in verses 3 through 5, note all of the personal pronouns. He said, thy and thee and thine, all referring to his soul. By the way, forgetting is far more than just failing to remember something. Are y'all still there? The word carries the idea of turning from God to follow other gods. So David is not just saying, don't remember what God has done for you. He's saying, don't you turn away from God and start following other gods. Are y'all still there? A lapse of spiritual memory will cause the saint to wander, to fall off the beaten path, to go and to drift away. Lapse in spiritual memory will cause that in your soul. It will cause your soul not to be excited anymore about what God has done for you. And you will begin to get all excited in the things that the Lord has given to you, but forget where it came from. David wants his soul to contemplate all of the benefits which the Lord has given to him. And the word benefits mean dealings. It means how the Lord has dealt with you. If the Lord has dealt fairly with you, then you ought to remember what the Lord has done with you. It refers to how the Lord has treated your soul. Are y'all still there? You know, I find it very interesting, you know, looking back at the original language and looking at the word benefit, I find it very interesting that the word benefit has the same root word as camel. I thought that was interesting because in the old Middle Eastern, the camel was important, and it can't be overstated how important the camel was. It was called the ship of the desert. Are y'all still out there?
Yeah.
They carried great burdens over long distances through harsh terrain, and if you've ever been close to a camel, they're not anything pleasant to look upon. And they don't smell so nice. And they will spit on you. Amen. And one of these days I'll give you share with you a video I took when I was in Jordan, over in Jordan at I can't remember the place anyway, but it was on the tombs of Indiana Jones. He'll come back to me one day. Amen. One of the people that was with me was riding on the camel, and I didn't want to ride on the camel. They didn't want to get close to the camel. They didn't want to smell the camel. So I was filming them as they were riding on the camel, and the camel was, the one that was behind her was right up on it, and he was picking on her backpack, and he opened that backpack up and went down in the backpack and pulled something out, and I got it all on film. They're crafty.
Yeah.
They're clever.
Yeah.
They're important. They are needful for the person who lives in the Middle East. They can survive long periods of time with little food and little water. They're essential to travel across the burning sand in the desert. And you can arrive safely with your camel. So I thought it was interesting that the word benefit has the same root word as the camel, because the camel carries all of when God is taking care of our burdens and carrying us across the desert sand and the burning sand, and will end us up where we need to be safely without us burning out. I think that's something we ought to be thankful for.
Amen.
Y'all still there?
Yes.
Like the camels, the benefits of God are able to transport the saints across vast barren deserts, and we don't have to worry about our feet getting tired. Somebody needs to say amen.
Amen.
Sometimes the soul just forgets how good God is and how good God continues to be. I don't know, we said it in the class this morning. We're just glad that the Lord is here. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. He woke me up this morning. I'm standing here before you. You're sitting out there listening to me. Amen, if you can. Just good to be here. Somebody say it's better to be on this side than the other side. It's better to be on top of the ground than under the ground. I don't know about you, but I'm glad to just be here. Somebody said in the class, I woke up with all of my pain, and I'm glad I got my pain. Amen. It's good to be able to feel pain. Somebody need to say amen. Good to be able to reach up with your pain into the pain medicine cabinet and pull out the pain reliever. Sometimes the soul just forget how good the Lord has been. Is it not true that we allow ourselves to get caught up in the problems and troubles of life so much that we forget what the Lord has done and how far the Lord has brought us? We think about the small things in life. You know, sometimes we get a little bit perturbed about things that really don't really matter in life. Amen? You know, I'm just glad that we sometimes have the ability to complain about some things, but sometimes the things that we complain about don't make any sense at all. And if y'all don't mind, I'd like to make a public apology to my wife. I made it to her at home, you know. She was talking a little loud in the bathroom this morning. I said, you know, can you lower your voice a little bit? She reminded me that I talk loud sometimes, and now that I'm thinking about it, I'm just glad I was able to hear her. She was able to yell loud. Amen. She could have been talking loud just because I couldn't hear that well. I'm thankful I had to ask her to turn it down somewhere. Somebody ought to say amen. Amen if you can. Get all upset about stuff that really don't matter. Think about why. I'm thankful I was able to hear. Amen. Are we guilty of allowing our eyes to wander from the Lord? Why? Because God never changed. The Hebrew writer says in Hebrews 13 and verse 8, the Lord is the same today, tomorrow, and yesterday, and forevermore. Amen. Yesterday, today, and forevermore. Sometimes my soul forgets just who God is and what God has done for me. Sometimes I need a reminder of the benefits I enjoy as a child of God. Today, as the Lord gives me liberty, I just want to share with you a few things. I want to point out the blessings that the soul sometimes forgets. Y'all got time?
Yes.
I got five things I want to say, and I'm going to say them in a hurry because I ain't got that much time. Amen. If you listen in a hurry, I'll try and hurry up in a hurry. You know, you see, the blessings and benefits I'm going to talk about today are for everyone who will come to God by faith. I believe God is saying, forget me not. Don't forget me. You know, you don't just send me a card occasionally saying that you haven't forgotten me. Come show up sometimes at the house of the Lord. Somebody ought to say amen. Father, the little girl was walking in the night, and the little girl said to the father, I'm going to count the stars. And she got up to 27, and she said 25, and then she said, she looked at her dad, and she said, I didn't realize there were so many stars up there. And the father said, you know, that's just like the blessings of the Lord. You can't count. They're too numerous to count. God blesses us with so many things. If I were to try and count all the blessings that the Lord has given to me, I would have to sigh and say that I would never stop counting because God has blessed me on so many occasions and day by day. I told somebody the other day, you know, I remember what David said. I have never seen the righteous of the Lord forsaken or begging bread. Now, you know, I might have to eat that bread with some peanut butter. Amen?
Right.
But I still got some bread. Somebody else say amen. Amen. Even if I don't have any and jelly. And even if I don't have any peanut butter, as long as I've got the bread. If you had to count your blessings today, I would count the fact that God has forgiven my sins. I just want to let you know that He forgives the sinner in me. That's the first blessing that the Lord has given to you. God forgives the sinner in me. Man's grave need makes the top of David's list. David uses the word iniquities. Iniquities, the word means bit or crookedness. So David said, Lord, you have forgiven my iniquities. You have forgiven my bit. You have forgiven my iniquities. And in case you don't know what the word bit means, you know when you get a small tree, and some of you who are gardeners out there know what I'm talking about. If you don't want that tree to bend over, you will take it and tie it on three ways, three sides, and make sure that it grows up straight. But if you allow that tree just to grow naturally, it's probably from the weight on the top is going to bend over, and when it grows old, it's going to be crooked. Somebody ought to say amen. Amen. Now, I like what the Lord is capable and able to do. The Lord is able to forgive my crookedness. Some of y'all don't know what bent means. Some of y'all don't know what iniquity means. But you know what crookedness means. Somebody ought to say amen. Somebody say he's a crook or she's a crook. It refers to the evil bit in our nature that pulls us towards Satan. You know, one thing about photosynthesis, and I learned back in when I was in elementary school, and they showed us and they taught us with plants, and you take a plant or a flower and you put it by the window, and you watch the leaves. They'll turn toward the sunlight. Are y'all still there? And that's what David is saying. The Lord forgive the fact that I've got some tendency to turn toward sin. And the Lord will help me to turn away from that sin and cause me to go in a different direction. He said, the Lord has forgiven the sinner in me. Forgives all of my iniquities, all the iniquities of my soul. And that is, he takes our sins and put them as far away from God's self as there is from the east from the west. Are y'all still out there?
Right.
And he did that by putting Jesus on Calvary.
Yes.
Somebody said Calvary.
Calvary.
The Hebrew writer says in Hebrews 9:26, for then must he offer him, he often have suffered since the foundation of the world, but now, once in the end of the world, has he appeared to put away our sins by sacrificing himself. Jesus died for you. You should have been on that cross. You should have died out there naked and beaten and with a crown of thorns upon your head. And incidentally, I think sometimes we like the pictures that we have, but because people can't stand to look at the shame that Jesus went through, they put clothes on him. But my Lord was naked. John 1 in verse number 29 says, the next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and said, behold, the Lamb of God, which take away the sins of the world. You can't forget that Jesus did something for you that you could not do for yourself or were not willing to do for yourself and are not willing to do for yourself. Are y'all still out there? Now all of our sins, past, present, and future, have been forgiven and put away through the gift of God in Jesus Christ. And in Psalm 103 and verse number 12, the Bible says, as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgression from us. I think, folks, what he's trying to say is, he's put your sins so far that if you don't want to find them, you will never find them.
Amen.
Let me say that again. If you go back and pick up your old habits and your old sin, you deliberately went looking for them. Are y'all still there? Because God has put them so far that if you don't want to go back and find them, you will never find them. So simply he's saying, when you get back into the stuff that you get back into, you went looking for it. I know sometimes we say, oh, we fall back into it, we slip back into it. Yeah, there's a possibility that you might slip back into it. But the likelihood is that you went looking for it, and because you went looking for it, you found it. Amen. When I was in the military, I remember the officers come in, and the superior officers come in, and they want to check for dust when you're going through basic training. They put on a white glove. Amen? Amen. Put on a white glove and go way back in the top of the locker. So the smart soldier will clean way back in the back of the locker and leave the rest of it alone. Amen. That's where you go check, that's where I'm gonna clean. Well, that's the way some of us live our lives. I know how to manipulate, and I know how to get by, I know how to get around, and I know how to get over it. I gotta keep on moving, amen. You know, Isaiah said it like this, behold, for peace I have great bitterness, but thou hast in love to my soul delivered it from the pits of corruption, for thou hast cast all my sins behind my back. And I don't have to worry about it anymore. Now that you've gone down into the water, as we talked about last, we've been to the water. Now you come up a new creature. All things have passed away. All things have become new. You are no longer walking in the darkness. You are in the light because all that stuff has been put behind you. But if you walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all of our unrighteousness. No. I want you to pay attention to something in this text. Because, no, in all five of the verbs in this text are in has an ET. If you got the old King James Bible, yeah, some of y'all got the old King James Bible, and it starts with ET, or ends with ET at the end. He forgiveth, he healeth, he redeemeth. Are y'all there? He crowneth, he satisfieth. Thou divinity. Y'all get that one a little bit. All of it ends in E-T-H. E-T-H in the old Elizabethan English or King James English meant the present tense. So it's not that God is not in the present right here now. He's forgiving my sin right now. He's healing me right now. He's crowning my head right now. He's healing me right now. He's redeeming me right now. Are y'all still there? Right now. See, it is one thing because you've been to the water, but it's good to know that God has a continuous hold on you. God has a continuous fix on you. God has a lock on you. Somebody ought to say amen. Amen. And the word, he not only cleansed me in the past, but he continues to cleanse me in the present, and he will continue to cleanse me in the future. And the Bible says all I need to do is confess my sin. Amen. Be honest. Are y'all still out there? Does this mean that we are sinless? Absolutely not. We sin, and the accuser of the brethren, according to Revelation chapter 12 and verse number 10, the devil stands before the Lord, pointing out all your sins. And the accuser of the brethren stands before the Lord and constantly points out everything that you're doing wrong. Every time you fall into one of your things, every time you go looking for your sin, somebody ought to say amen. You know, he did it to Job. He said, now, will Job truly serve the Lord if the Lord took away all of the benefits? And God said, well, let's see. When he does this accusing of the saints has an advocate who stands beside when their accuser makes accusations. Oh, y'all still out there? Pointing fingers at folk. 1 John chapter 2 and verse number 1 simply is the advocate simply holds up his nail, printed his hands and said, it's painful. Accuse all you want. Say whatever you want to say. It's paid for.
Yes.
I died on the cross.
Yes.
And the accusation you are making doesn't have any weight anymore. Somebody ought to say amen.
Amen.
Because they have been redeemed.
Yes.
They have been justified.
Yes.
Somebody needs to say amen.
Amen.
We don't have to know what sin you're talking about. We don't know what kind of sin you're talking about because it's all been paid for. It's all been reconciled. And that person is a child of God, and they are righteous through the blood of the Lamb, and their sins are forgiven, and all is forgotten.
Yes.
I don't know if that makes you happy, but it makes me happy. Somebody needs to say amen. As sinners, he forgave me. So he forgives the sinner in me. See if I can hurry up because I got a lot to say. I don't like to do two quarters too much. But I might have to. Then he heals the sickness in me. You know, it's the problem, why you go back and look for stuff that you... Somebody needs to say it. You know, I have to caution folk. In the church when they make too many promises. See, we like to read the brochure and tell folk that all the stuff that you were dealing with when you go down in the water, you're not going to deal with it anymore when you come up out the water. Well, that's not what it's saying. It's saying all the stuff you did before you went in the water. You're a new creature. You got a new start. But you know what? Sometimes, you go back and want to do the same old stuff because you have that muscle memory.
Amen.
Amen. You see, Sister McGill probably can talk to this with you too. And if any of you play piano or guitar or anything, you practice playing and switching chords and stuff, and it's called muscle memory. And after a while, you don't have to look at it anymore. You just do it by muscle memory. And some of us are still operating on our muscle memory when we come out of the water, and we still want to act the same way. We react the same way. We jerk the same way because the same thing that we went down in with, it's washed off. It's taken out. But the old muscles are still need to be retrained now. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
And so he heals the sickness in me. These bodies we wear are often afflicted with sickness and disease. But this verse is not referring to physical healing. It's referring to soul healing.
Yes.
Yes. People, for their physical affliction, regardless of what some preachers say, is referring to the sickness of the soul and not so much your physical healing. Or God can heal physically. But this is talking about your soul, because David is dealing with the soul, the inner man, the real man, the man that's housed in that body that you have. Our souls are subject to many terrible things. Among some is lust and hate and greed and jealousy and discouragement and depression and anger and fear and guilt and doubt.
Yeah.
All those things are lurking around trying to destroy our souls. Are y'all still there? Thank God. God has remedy for the disease of the soul. And this word also is in the present tense. And each day the divine physician visited his patients, and through his grace he tenderly and effectively heals all the diseases that you got going on in you. Somebody needs to say
amen.
Of course, to effect this healing, we need to take our medicine. Psalm 107, 17 through 21 says this: fools, because of their transgression and because of their iniquities, are afflicted. Their souls abhor all manner of meat, and they draw near unto the gates of death. Then they cry unto the Lord in their trouble. Now, let me say that again. The psalmist said, they get themselves in trouble. And they get close to the gates of death. And then they cry unto the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them out of their distress. He sent his word and healed heal them and deliver them from their destruction. Oh, that man would praise the Lord for his goodness and for the wonderful works to the children of man. When God pulls you out of the fire, you ought to thank God. Somebody ought to say amen.
Amen.
How could the soul ever forget the tender touch of the great physician? And time again, God has diagnosed, treated, and healed your disease. Amen.
Amen.
We ought to thank God for his help and for his healing. And that I've received. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. We must never forget the sacrifice of Jesus. We must never forget the grace of God. We must never forget the cost of our redemption. We must never forget our original destination.
Yes.
We must never forget the value of our soul. We must never forget the benefit of our forgiveness. And we must never forget the source of our victory. Are y'all there?
Yeah.
And finally, we don't need to forget the reason of our hope. The reason we have hope is because Jesus died on the cross. Y'all, let me hurry up. He forgave the sinner in me.
Right.
He healed the sickness in me. But you know, he also redeemed the slave in me.
Yeah.
Paul said, you know, I was a slave to sin.
Right.
And every soul that enters this world, in verse number 4, every soul that enters this world is a slave to sin. According to Romans chapter 3 and verse number 23, he says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. I don't know if all means you, but I think that all includes you. And the reason why I say I don't know if all means you, because sometimes we have a way of excluding ourselves out of stuff. Amen. Galatians chapter 3 and verse number 22, every soul is headed to a horrible conclusion. The Bible says, but the scripture has concluded all under sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given unto them that believe. We are headed to a horrible conclusion if we don't believe in Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 6 and verse number 23, for the wages of sin is what? Death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Thank God. God saw our plight and sent redemption our way. Somebody need help me this morning. Amen. If you can, let me just try and get on down to the end. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless the Lord's holy name. Jesus sought me when I was a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He rescued me from danger and poured his precious blood upon me. Amen?
Amen.
Notice who God is. Knowing helps a little bit. Jehovah Jireh. The Lord will see to it. Jehovah Shalom. The Lord is my peace.
Yes.
Jehovah Rohi, y'all like this one. The Lord is my shepherd. Jehovah Shema, the Lord is there. Oh, the Lord is here. Amen, if you can. Jehovah Rapha, the Lord is our healer. Jehovah Nissi, the Lord is our banner. We ought to do it because of his namesake. Y'all still out there? Jehovah Symphony. The Lord is our righteousness. And God forgives the sinner within me. God heals the sickness in me. God redeemed the slave in me. And I'm no longer a slave to sin. But then in verse 4 he said, he also crowns the son in me. You know, when kings pass on their crown, in the olden days and even today, they don't pass it on to just anybody. Amen?
Amen.
They pass it on to the oldest son, or the one that has been groomed, or the daughter who will become queen. Amen, if you can. The psalmist said that like a king passing down the power and glory of his kingdom to a beloved son, the people of God are crowned with the blessings of the Lord's great kingdom.
You ought to know you are kings and queens. Why are you running around acting like peasants?
Amen.
Amen if you can.
We're told that he crowns his child with loving kindness and tender mercy. Loving kindness corresponds to the New Testament word that we call grace. So loving kindness is this grace that God is imparting unto you. All of us want grace, so God gives us loving kindness. And then not only is loving kindness there, but God gives tender mercies. And tender mercies corresponds to that as well. It's when you get that grace, sometimes you don't want the punishment, you want mercy.
First,
2 Corinthians 12, verse number 9 says, and he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. My gladness, most gladly, therefore, I would rather glory in my infirmities than through the power of Christ, that I might rest where God has given me rest. Somebody else say amen. Tender mercies carry the idea of compassion and tender love. His grace is matchless and marvelous, but his tender mercy are glorious beyond vocabulary's ability to describe. Are y'all still out there? This brings to mind the tender touch of a mother. There's something in the touch that communicates love, peace, safety, and well-being when a mother cradles her baby in her arms. Are y'all still out there? That baby might cry with daddy. Somebody else say amen. Might cry with a stranger, but when mama says, hand them over to me. And all of a sudden, the baby stops crying. Are y'all still there? Lamentation says it like this. It is of the Lord's mercy that we are not consumed. Because his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Amen.
Amen.
Great is thy faithfulness. There have been times when human touch and words were ineffective in life. It was said that, you know, when in World War II, when the soldiers from America went over to the foreign countries, they often made it with the young maidens over there, and they would have children, and the babies were put in orphanages, and nobody would touch them. And those babies died shortly thereafter because they didn't have the human touch. And one nurse began to take those babies and just hold them, and their life began to last a little bit longer because they were getting that human touch. We all need to be touched. And when we get God's human, God's loving mercies and tenderness and loving kindness, it causes us to flourish as children of God. Somebody need to help me. Notice that he does not just say mercies. He says tender mercies. He doesn't just say kindness. He says loving kindness. We serve a God who always operates in the superlative. You know, in creation, he operated in the superlative. Genesis 1 and verse number 20, he says, let the waters break forth abundantly. God doesn't just give you what you need. God give you more than you need. Somebody say amen. And in victory, he operates in the superlative. And in Exodus 15 and verse number 1, he has triumphed gloriously. In salvation, he operates in the superlative. Hebrews 7 and 25, able to save to the utmost. To the uttermost. Are y'all still there?
Yeah.
God moves in the realm of over abundance. God always gives you more than you need. He operates in the arena of more than enough.
Amen.
We like to say that Jesus is all we need. Oh, Jesus is all we want. He will never be just enough. He will always be more than enough. Somebody else say amen. You know, how could my soul ever forget that he crowned me with loving kindness and tender mercies? When I think of his grace and his goodness toward me, I just always have to say, oh, bless the Lord, oh, my soul. And all that is within me, bless his holy name. Let me bring this thing to a close. Because y'all are ready to go home. You know, he forgives the sinner in me. He heals the sickness in me. He redeems the slave in me. He crowns the son in me. And verse number 5, he satisfies the saint in me. Are y'all still there?
Yes.
You know, as a glorious Heavenly Father, he gives his saints the good things of life.
Yes.
He does not always give us what we want.
Yes.
But God always gives us what is best for us. Romans 8:28 says that, amen.
Yes.
And we know that all things work together for the good of those that love the Lord and who will call according to his purpose. John 15:5 says, I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abides in me, and in him the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me you can do nothing. The psalmist says that when you are in the Lord, you shall be renewed like the eagle. Y'all don't mind if I close? Somebody say, yeah, something so happy. He said, you're going to be renewed like the eagle. I remember over in Isaiah, I believe it was chapter 40, the Bible said that you shall mount up on wings like an eagle. You see, you need to understand something about the eagle. The scientists tell me that the eagle, when the eagle gets old, anybody in here know what I'm talking about old? When the eagle gets old, calcium begins to build up on their beaks. Calcium builds up on their feet. And I talk to you about the birds and the way that they bend their knees and they're able to hold on to the branch because they bend their knees and it causes a contraction in their claws and it causes them to be able to hold on. But when the old eagle gets old, the old eagle gets calcium on his fingers. Anybody know anything about arthritis? You know, my fingers don't operate the way they used to operate. And they tell me the reason why is because calcium is beginning to build up around my joints and I can't bend them the way I used to bend them anymore. And that's what happens to the old eagle. The eagle begins to get calcium on his beak, and you know the eagle uses the beak to go out and find prey and everything. And not only does calcium build up on the beak and on the talons down there, the calcium, the old eagle wings begin to the feathers begin to turn a little bit, and now, when the old eagle gets ready to swoop down on the prey, he doesn't come down quiet like he used to, as swift as he used to. He whistles when he's coming down. And the prey knows that he's on his way because he can hear him trying to sneak up on him, and he can't do it anymore. And if he did sneak up on him, he can't grab him with his claw, but Arthur Anderson said it, and he can't bend his claws anymore like he used to. And if he caught him with the claw, that might catch the prey. If he was possible to sneak up on him, he can't kick it with the beak because the beak hurt now because it's all calcium size. Yeah. So that old eagle just do what he needs to do. He going to find him somewhere in between the rocks and where he can go down into a deep valley and find him a rock. And he just stands there on that rock and just beats his beak against that rock, trying to knock that calcium off. And he'll just beat his feet on it, beat his feet on it. And eventually, all of his feathers will fall out. But while he's down in the valley, something wonderful happens. Other eagles will fly over and drop some food down to take care of it. And scientists tell me that it's the old eagles that do that, not the young ones. Why are you saying that? Because the old eagles know that they're going to be there in a little bit. While they're still able to do what they can do, they take care of the other ones. So after the old eagle beats the calcium off of his beak and calcium off of his talons and his feathers grow back, he's able to come out. And that's what it's talking about when it talks about renewing as an eagle. See, the eagle renews himself and then he's able to get back up. But while he's down, he's dependent on others to take care of him. Y'all still out there?
And so when I'm talking about all the benefits that the Lord is giving, I'm trying to help you understand that those benefits come through the old evil sometimes or come through others, and you need to depend on other folks. And because your talents have now gotten all calcium size, and your beak has become calcium size, and your wings are no longer has feathers on, you got to depend on other folks to take care of you. And that's not always easy to do, is it? Because you used to be an independent and on your own, and you are able to do it by yourself, and you don't need anybody else. But the Bible says that we are not to ever be without community. Because when you're down, somebody else will come and help you out. And it says the old eagle do it. I wonder why the young eagle don't do it. Because sometimes the young eagles can't truly appreciate what it means to go through pain and suffering. They don't understand where you've been and how you suffered and what you've gone through. And when you've gone through some stuff, you can be there to empathize and sympathize with other folks. But when you haven't gone through anything, you don't have any reason to care about what other folks are going through, because it ain't going to ever happen to you. Are y'all still out there?
Yes.
So he restores, he restores or forgives the sinner in me. Amen.
Amen.
He redeems my soul.
Yes.
The Lord is there for me.
Yes.
But he satisfies me. And I don't have time to tell you that he drops the sweet morsel down into your mouth and fills your stomach with all the things that you need, because God is satisfying you and satisfying you and satisfying you. And you don't have any reason to go anywhere else. You know, when the refrigerator is stocked up, I don't have to go out and get anything. Amen.
Amen.
I can just stay right at home.
Amen.
If you're getting everything you need at home, why are you going out? Somebody ought to say amen. If you got everything right here that you need, why do you have to go somewhere else to fast? Why do you have to go out and get it from somewhere else? And remember, I told you that the word there where he says forget, the word forget does not just mean to have a short memory. It means that you are seeking after other gods. And you're going out looking for something somewhere else that God has already provided for you here in the house. The refrigerator is full. Why do I need to go and find it somewhere else? The Bible says in him we move and breathe and have our very being. I don't need to look somewhere else. Somebody can say amen. But if you don't have what you need here, then you will go out looking for something else. And if you don't appreciate what you have here, then you will go out looking for something else. If you are never satisfied with what you have, then you will always go out looking for something else. Somebody will say amen. You know, we just like that. We're like that. You know, I needed another tablet. My tablet that I was using was not working the way I wanted it to work, and I was up there trying to do my sermon, and it would just go all over. And that's why a lot of times y'all didn't know. I just come out because I couldn't find where I was, not to say, Lord, yeah. So now I got a brand new one. But you know, after I bought it, I got to think. I only got 2 gigabytes of RAM. I should have got the one with the 3 gigabytes in the pen. But I don't really need that. All I want to do is just preach my sermon all the day. I don't really need a pen to draw with and all that. You know what I mean? Never satisfied. Always wondering if we could get something that's going to be better. And we do that with Jesus Christ. I wonder if this church over here is a little bit better than this church over here. Can I go find it somewhere else? God led you here because this is where God wanted you to find what you needed. And now you will go check somewhere else to see if there's something better. I'm going to compare, because we are comparing to shoppers. And you know, the one thing that I did when I did try to buy the tablet, they have this thing where you can compare them on there. You know, you put this one over here, you put this one over here, then you look at all the specs. And I went out, that one got that, that one got that, that one got that, that one got that. And we do that with church. We do that with God. Well, I wonder if they serve Jesus a little bit better than they serve him over here. Did they put some pepper on him over here? Did they put some pepper? Do they serve Jesus with kale over here?
Amen.
You found what you need. Why aren't you satisfied? Why don't you be satisfied with what the Lord is giving you right now, rather than trying to find something else that you will never find?
Amen.
be satisfied.
Yes. Yes.
The Bible says the Lord satisfied my soul.
Yes.
And if I'm satisfied, then I ought to be sanctified.
Amen.
Where I can be glorified.
Yes.
Because I've been justified.
Yes.
See, all of that. And you need something this morning that you have not found, and you need to come on down and let the Lord give it to you right now, because the Lord will give you all five of these things this morning. Let's come. While we stand and sing.
Will you be free from your burden?
Where you go?
There is